29-year-old Ben Courson is director of Hope Generation and an incredibly gifted communicator. He preached his first message in third grade, started a weekly home Bible study at age 16 that packed out the house with hundreds of high schoolers, and became a full-time pastor, reaching tens of thousands weekly from Oregon to Africa. Very glad that your program, Hope Generation, is aired across the OLC Broadcasting Network on FETV and World Harvest Television as well. So, you're already got more years in the ministry than more years out of the ministry, and you're 29 years old.
I've never thought about that, but yes, most of my life has been spent in ministry. In fact, I remember the first Bible study I ever gave, I was in third grade, and I came up and read from Ezekiel, the story of the dry bones, and then I sat down. And it was the best Bible study I ever gave because I didn't muddy it up with my comments. I just read the Bible and sat down, and that word never returns void. So
what was it like, though? I mean, as a senior in high school, pastoring a church at same time, alongside, and I mean, that's a lot of responsibility, and you're dealing with obviously a lot of hurting humanity in so many different ways.
That's right. Yeah. There's this movie called Amazing Grace that really inspired me in my youth.
Is it the one about the slave abolitionist,
William Wilberforce.
Oh, that's it, Wilberforce.
And he was talking to William Pitt the Younger, who became the youngest British prime minister ever at the age of 24. Mm. And Pitt the Younger said, "I'm going to run for office." And Wilberforce said, "But no one of our age has ever taken power." And Pitt responded, "Which is why we're too young to realize that certain things are impossible, so we'll do them anyway." Mm. Mm-hmm. And I like that. I figure that we ought to attempt great things for God and expect great things from God while we're young, because some of my favorite Bible characters did great things at a young age. Mm-hmm. Josiah was 8 years old when he became king. I mean, could you imagine your president is playing with coloring crayons?
Yeah.
So I figure, why not attempt great things young as well?
So have you been met with any resistance, especially taking over a church at full-time ministry at 16 years old? Was it met with any resistance? The older generation, how did they feel about you?
Oddly, I feel like the older generation has been very supportive. Mm-hmm. I like to tell older people, you know, Caleb, when he was 85 years old in the Bible, was taking on Anakim giants at 85 years old. It's as if he would say, "There's snow on the rooftop, but fire in the furnace." Mm-hmm. So you need the older generation, but also the younger generation to provide that enthusiasm. The Bible says old men will dream dreams and young men will see visions. And when you can get the two generations to meld like that, I think it's a perfect storm. Mm. So there's resistance, but Paul told Timothy, "Let no man despise your youth." And I've kind of taken that to heart.
So tell us about Hope Generation. One of the things that characterize your ministry and message is just this undeniable, really vibrant hope that you want to communicate to the world at large. And tell us a little bit about why hope and how that message formed in your heart.
Yeah, it's interesting. 20 years ago, we had Johnny Cash alive. Mm-hmm. We had Bob Hope. And we had Steve Jobs.
Cash, hope, and jobs.
Now we have no cash, no hope, and no jobs. And I like to pray, "Lord, don't let Kevin Bacon die."
Yeah.
You know, but I think it's amazing. We live better than kings used to live, and yet antidepressants are the number one category prescription drugs that are sold right now. And I feel like our generation is bereft of hope, has a dearth of hope, and Paul called our Lord the God of hope. Yeah. In Romans 15:13. So Hope Generation is a pun. We want to create a generation of hope, but also to generate hope, to create hope in the listener's heart and in the watcher's heart as well. Mm-hmm.
Well, Ben, we certainly needed hope during the election. What are your thoughts about the political climate here in the United States and your view of the Bible? So how do you blend the two?
Yeah, it's interesting with this election. I would argue that we perhaps are more divided now over this election as a country. We're more like the divided states of America as opposed to the United States of America, with Hillary and Trump running against each other. And there's a great sense of division over this last year. But I think it's interesting how in the Bible, in the book of Revelation, 17 of the 22 chapters, on 45 occasions, John the Revelator, he speaks of a throne, which was a very politically charged, you know, symbol in that time. Mm-hmm. And what he was saying is all of history is moving toward a throne, not a democracy, not a monarchy, not a tyranny, not an autocracy, but a theocracy where the rule and reign of God comes as perfectly to earth as it is in heaven. Mm-hmm. So I think whether you follow the donkey or whether you follow follow the elephant, we as Christians are very blessed because we follow the lamb.
Yeah. Wow, that's good. That's real good. When it comes to connection with the millennial generation, you're a millennial as well, and so much has changed over the last 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. It's just really kind of mind-boggling. How do you capture the hearts, or really not convince, but persuade the truth claims of Christianity and the personhood and the reality of the presence of God in the person of Christ to this millennial generation? Yeah. What are they looking for?
Yeah, well, one of the things we've done is we've used YouTube as a major means of getting the message of hope out. We have a YouTube channel called Hope Generation as well. Mm-hmm. Because listen to this, the average 8 to 18-year-old spends 7 hours and 38 minutes every day indulging in media entertainment.
Wow.
That's 53 hours a week. That's a full work week, plus 13 hours overtime, playing video games, surfing the internet, watching TV. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is because research is now showing that social media triggers the same part of your brain as drugs. Hmm. It's called a dopamine loop. It activates a dopamine loop neurologically, so it's very addictive. Hmm. And so we want to give people something deeper, something even more tangible than mere social media. And I feel like we have a great breadth of knowledge because we have the internet, but we lack a depth of knowledge. Mm-hmm. And I feel like what the scriptures offer us is a depth of knowledge. And the teleologic purpose of the scriptures, Paul said, Romans 15:4, is to give us hope. Mm-hmm. So I feel like we're looking for deeper meaning than mere social media.
Mm-hmm. And I'd imagine that the older generation can provide that depth of knowledge
for
the younger generation. So how do you encourage baby boomers to get in the throes and start reaching a younger generation with the gospel?
Yeah, I think that if we're willing to listen to the older generation, I don't necessarily talk to the older generation about you guys need to talk to us, because you guys are. I more like to talk to my age group and say, we need to listen. It's been said, if you ask a question, you'll look like a fool for 5 minutes, but you'll be wise for life. Mm-hmm. If you don't ask a question, you'll appear wise for 5 minutes, but you'll be a fool for life. So I think we need to be like Isaac Newton, who said, I have seen further because I have stood on the shoulders of giants. So we need to be willing to listen to the older generation. I think that's very important.
Ben, tell us about Anthology of a 20-Year-Old Soul. Seems to be really just a little snapshot or glimpse into what makes Ben Courson tick, and very poetic, very well written. I was very impressed by just the quality of the style that you have in communicating through the printed page.
Well, I wrote that when I was 19 and 20 years old, and I always wondered, what would it be like to be Peter walking on a lake? What would it have been like to be Jonah in the enzymes and digestive system of a whale? What would it have been like to be let down through a roof and be healed by Jesus during the middle of one of his sermons as, you know, the roof is collapsing? And I wanted to write it from the first-person perspective with imagination of the Bible characters.
Yeah.
So that's what a lot of the stories are about. And they're also meditations and poetry and prayers as well. So it's a collection of 20 writings for the 20 years that I was alive at the time.
I'm gonna put you on the spot here. You got your camera right there. And for someone watching today, maybe you're watching right now and just hope's kind of drained out. And the, I'll use the word trauma of what we've gone through as a nation over the last year or so, and seems to be continuing today, is just draining hope from your heart. Would you pray for that person today?
Yes. Lord, I want to pray for the person who is lacking hope today. I think of that big hashtag right now, hashtag the struggle is real. Lord, remind us that hashtag the struggle is real, but so is God. Life is tough, but God is tougher. Life is a battle, but the battle is the Lord's. So I pray that our faith would not be dictated by our circumstances, but rather our circumstances would always be dictated by our faith. In Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 Thanks for joining us, Ben. Ben Courson, our guest today. To connect with Ben, you go to bencourson.com. Always, you can go to our website, harvest-tv.com. And you can also catch Hope Generation here on the LaCie Broadcasting Network on WHT Sundays at 10 p.m. and on FETV right after the Harvest Show at 9:30 a.m. We'll be back in just a minute. Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, guys. Yeah. Do I head over here?